I guess this is the part where we get started, huh?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Maybe once or twice a year, I'm gripped by a complete inability to begin a podcast, and I don't know what that's about.
Well, we're here to get you through it.
All right, here we go.
Supportive. And
all right, in the game. Let's do this. Welcome, everybody, to a very special episode of the Run Button Podcast. This is going to be our spoiler cast for The Witness, where we talk about everything in that game. There's a lot to spoil there. My name, Kyle Churchill, as usual, here with special guests John Davies, a.k.a. John Button.
Hi there.
And Austin Walker of GiantBomb.com.
How's it going?
Good.
Good.
Doing all right here.
Witness.
The Witness. It's, man, it's been like...
Man.
It's been a few weeks.
It's been a while.
Wait, so, what is The Witness? First off.
Oh, Lord.
John, you're right. I probably should have primed you on this before I had you on.
For the spoiler cast.
Yeah. Guys, is it too late to do a Witness spoiler cast?
I think it's just the right time, actually.
The way I feel right now is often the way The Witness makes me feel. So I think this might be actually appropriate.
Because of The Witness, or you just feel that way for
you
external
just feel
reasons?
Lost.
Feel lost and tired and like fatigued and kind of like I hate myself. I hate the game, but I also kind of love it. But also, you know. Yeah.
Yeah,
why don't okay, how about we just start there? What do you think
Austin,
of The Witness?
You start. Hey. No, okay. Me? Or
yeah,
you?
Yeah, you. Mm.
Why is this so hard?
Yeah, start,
I
Kyle.
Kind of like The Witness. I think that I liked a lot of the puzzles. I think it's sometimes really clever and also really cold and dry, and it refuses to have any personality, except for at the very, 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 very post-game end, it finally gets a little bit of it, and that stuff is really cool, but that's at like hour 50, so who cares? That's my incredibly short version of what I feel about The Witness.
Or it could be at minute 5, depending on how
could be at minute 1.
Yeah.
Right.
I love that. Yeah, so... Because this is a spoiler cast, we can go ahead and talk about it. I love that they do the missed thing of that you can basically finish the game in 2 seconds if you want.
Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm.
I've heard people say that they don't like that, like they were bothered by it in Myst, and it's always been a little confusing to me. Like as if they were somehow disappointed that it could have been finished sooner or something.
What's the trick in Myst again? Refresh my memory just real quick.
It's like... there are those weird, like, up and down switches all over the island, and I think you have to put one of them up and the rest of them down or something like that, and then the first switch you find, it will open, like, a cabinet, and it gives you, like, a map that you then go into the library and pull down a weird thing over the fireplace and punch in, the design or whatever, and then the game's over.
Okay.
Is that a thing that you would just have naturally gotten around to in Myst?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the thing. It's like the entire game of Myst leads you up to that point,
right.
Or you could just go do it if you knew about it.
Right. Well, I guess it's sort of a thing you could do in The Witness. Like you can do
exactly.
So you can do like the sun puzzle at the very beginning,
yeah.
And get that ending. But you still, if you wanted to do the quote unquote regular ending of that game, you'd still have to at least go through some of the
right.
puzzle segments.
Yeah.
So I guess maybe that's where we should start.
Well, I want to give some quick impressions.
Sure.
I actually loved this game.
Okay.
Like, obviously, it's the year just started, but right now, this is at my number one spot for game of the year, and it needs to be dethroned by something.
Right.
Yeah, I loved every minute of it, basically, even the times where I was pulling my hair up because the puzzle was so difficult. It wasn't until, like, the very end of the main... game, basically. It was that puzzle where you're like, it's like a big floor with the four smaller puzzles inside of it.
Okay, the Tetris one right before the
really hard
that
water
drove
pillars.
Me, yeah, I had so much trouble with that because it was basically forcing you to, in a way, learn a new mechanic that hadn't been taught to you before, which felt really unlike the rest of the game. And so that kind of put me off a little bit, and I was a little underwhelmed by the ending. And
I was
then
there,
And then there was sort of like some ups and downs from there, where I was kind of like, you know, when I discovered the cave with John's help. John was a great help to me. Like, I didn't really go on the internet very much for any hints, with one notable exception. But I did ask John to nudge me a few times.
And I was really helpful. Just filtering what I had shamelessly looked up on the internet to you.
Yeah, sure.
That's a good friend service, though. That's nice.
Yeah.
Well, I gave it to him in, like, clever ways. I'm like, do this, look at it this way, but without outright telling him.
Yeah, you did me a service. When I got to the caves, I got really excited. Like, oh, I was almost sad when the game was over, just because I had enjoyed it so much. And then when I discovered the caves, I was like, oh, great, there's more of this game. But it was really like a bunch of puzzles you didn't really have to do, and then just like the world's most obnoxious challenge of all time.
I actually love that challenge. It might be my favorite thing in this game.
That's so funny, because like when I first discovered that record player timed challenge thing, when I realized like what was going on, like, oh shit, I have to beat this thing before the song ends, like there was a huge smile on my face. I was like, that's the greatest thing. And then it took me like 6 hours to beat that fucking thing.
I'm still working on that. Okay. I haven't gotten it yet.
It's tough. It's really hard.
It's so hard.
The thing, so I've been trying to work out why it is that it works for me. One is just like, it's clever. You know, it's putting the best parts of The Witness have always been just like, aha, I get what this thing is doing. And so that moment was just really good. But the second thing is, I think the fact that there are, the fact that it's, I guess, procedurally generated puzzles, or else it's pulling from a huge pool of them.
It must be procedural, yeah.
For whatever reason, it prevents me from hating myself when I can't figure something out quickly.
Oh, what? Because you're just like, well, a computer made this, so it's fucking dumb.
You just got a bad roll.
I got a bad roll. Let me go start over. And I also just really liked the feeling of having a good run, where it's like, oh, shit, I got through the first part of this before it even hit that one part of the song. Like, I'm already up to the set of three puzzles. Yeah. And that was like a great feeling.
I don't know if I'm imagining things, but I'm plowing my way through this challenge, and I feel like every time the like that second set of four puzzles that activate in a random order, there's the symmetry one with the white and orange lines. I feel like those ones are like getting harder and harder, because like each time I'm like, "There's no way this is possible."
Yeah,
and when they started out, I was like, "Oh yeah, I'll just do that," but I feel like maybe it's just in my mind. But
yeah, those are blue and yellow lines, by the way. Are you colorblind?
They're not that I know of. They're definitely blue and yellow.
They're definitely blue and yellow.
100%.
Hold on. I have someone next to me who has been helping me out by taking pictures. Are those lines blue or white?
They're blue.
Ah, fuck. Maybe I am colorblind.
Jesus Christ.
Everyone just learned a very special thing about John.
This is a very intimate moment we've had.
Yeah. Wow. This is...
Here's right, the guys. Thing. Is that dress? Look at this dress and tell me if it's golden,
yeah,
white,
that's
or black
what I was
and blue.
Thinking.
Here's the thing I hated about those procedurally generated puzzles is that I don't know if you guys picked up on this or not, but most of the time, those black and white square puzzles that when you get three of them at a time and the other set of three, most of those were literally impossible to finish. Like, you couldn't beat them.
Yes.
Actually impossible?
Actually impossible.
So it's a set of three, and only one of the set of three is actually possible.
I don't think so. I feel like I got times when I would look at all three and go, all three of these are impossible. I have to kill this challenge and start over. And that's the fucking worst thing in the world.
That's how I felt. Yeah.
If they were ever... So my understanding was that it was supposed to be set up so that one of them would always be the right... Would always be doable. But that was a really weird thing of like... abstracting the knowledge I had, like you learn how to do those puzzles, and so that like feeling of like, oh yeah, this is, it's like looking at a math thing that's just like where it says 2 + 2 = 5 and your brain just automatically goes like, no, that's bullshit. Like being able to have that feeling about this weird puzzle that I'm looking at was a really cool thing. But if you're right, and sometimes it was, all three are completely impossible. Fuck that is the worst.
I'm with you, like what was so great about The Witness is that you spend so much time with these weird abstract ideas and these puzzles, and they, you internalize them so much and you get so good at them that it is a really interesting twist at the end to ask you to discern when they're not completable.
Yeah.
Maybe.
But perhaps. But yeah, if then there's ever a time when one of them is, none of them are finishable, then that kind of throws the coolness of that concept out the window. And I feel like more often than not, I was running into times when all three were impossible. And the thing is, I would be inclined to say, like, hey, maybe it's on me. Maybe I'm dumb and I couldn't, you know, I couldn't figure out which one was solvable. But, like, I spent a lot of fucking time doing those puzzles in that game, and I'm pretty sure that I got good enough to recognize when one of them was solvable.
On a similar note, just I found it kind of amusing going through Jonathan Blow's Twitter, and people would like tweet to him saying, "I'm stuck on this puzzle. It seems impossible. This can't be solvable." And he'll just respond going like, "Keep on working. Just do it. You'll get it."
I I'm going back to Austin when you were saying that it was the game was devoid of personality or whatever it was that you said.
That was maybe a too harsh, flippant analysis, but...
So I liked that aspect of it. I almost didn't understand why they gave you a character shadow, because I felt like it kind of pulled me out of the game a little bit.
That's interesting. Mm-hmm. I like that analysis a lot, actually.
Because it's sort of like when I'm playing Myst, and I think in Myst you're literally you... And that's the way I feel when I'm the witness. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, it's me in this thing. And then I look at that shadow and I'm like, well, that's not my fucking shadow. So I'm just some asshole.
No, man, something. It's the idealized version of yourself.
That I know.
Or something.
My idealized version of myself has way better walking animations than that.
Yeah, the idealized version of myself can totally jump off of a curb whenever I need to instead of having to walk around the long way.
Yeah.
So I guess to speak to that a little bit more... Again, I was being incredibly flippant when I said it didn't have personality. I think that they address this a little bit in the caves. There's an attempt to, especially with the vocal recordings, to curate a certain sort of like, oh, this is what the best of humanity has on offer in terms of like ideas. And that even like comes into the way the environments are designed in some ways, where it's like, this is almost like a survey of humanity. We have old ruins, we have nice towns, we have, you know, we have manufacturing, we have color, we have, you know, gardens.
Okay.
So I don't want to say there's no personality, but there is something about it. I've been working on a piece for like 3 weeks about this because
is that not done yet?
It's still not done, but whatever. Okay. I'm still just like hammering away at it and also like deleting it and going back to listen to different audio logs and stuff. But it feels so much like the story of humanity that game wants to tell through its audio logs is like, hey, everybody, like, and not just its audio logs, also through its like puzzle design even. Hey, everybody, I know you have problems. I know that there's, like, shit wrong with the world. But, hey, we're all human, and, like, we're all reasonable. We're all rational human beings. And if we just, like, sit down and think about it and do some science and, like, meditate a little bit, like, what's a problem? Like, a problem is just a thing we can solve if we just think it through. And I think that that's really hopeful, but also kind of facile and really, like... not engaged with the actual complexities of problems for people. This is like most seen in that big astronaut monologue that's at the top of the mountain. I don't know if you guys found that.
Rusty Schweikart one.
Yes. And it's a beautiful piece of writing. Like I think that it is well written prose, but there's something in it that just like gets under my skin where it's just like, you know, first I identified with Houston and then I went around the world enough times that I was identifying with North Africa and like, can't you see we're all one people? Mm. And like, yeah, but like that doesn't stop like hunger. That doesn't when people in a place are getting their doors kicked in by an oppressive police force. Like that doesn't the sit down and reason it out thing doesn't help them in any meaningful way. And that's such a Jonathan Blow sort of like he loves science and reason and rationality. Yeah. And I get that because I used to be that dude so hard. Mm. And I had
now
to like,
you fucking hate science.
I hate it. I hate it so much. No, I like it a bunch, and I think that's where the puzzles work so well, because like the puzzles are just like the scientific method made yeah. really fun, right? Which is like, ooh, I think this is how this works. Let me test it. Okay, right. That's wrong. How do I do that? So that's why I think it is actually pretty cohesive and pretty coherent, but I kind of just, it rubs me the wrong way until the very end, and you get the audio logs in the caves where you get the, did you see the sandwich one?
Mm-hmm.
So I got two audio logs in the cave, and I ran around that thing looking for more, and I'm not sure if there were more.
Yeah, there's like five in there.
Really?
Yes.
That can't be true.
No, there are five.
You're fucking lying.
I have not. I've only found two.
I got the one where the woman is like reading, it's like a Bible passage or something, mm-hmm. and then they break out of it, like that sort of like reveal one.
Yes, I like mm-hmm. that one a lot.
And then I got like, the one where they're
she's
having
like, I don't like sandwiches, that one.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, is that what it was? Yeah,
that's
yeah.
the one where she's like, she finishes the quote, and then she's like, and then this guy is like, I'm going to go out, do you want a sandwich or anything? And she's like, you know I don't like sandwiches. And it's like, I love that moment so much. It's like, oh shit, they're like people in this world and not just the floating ideas taken from Wiktionary or whatever.
Yeah. And I think that one is even preceded by, I think in another audio log, they talk about like proposing the idea of getting a sandwich for her. And he's like, huh, maybe I'll do that.
Man.
Isn't that
in one of the ones?
No, I didn't see that.
So it's like a through line.
I hate that moment, and here's why. And it gets to the point of Jonathan Blow not understanding humanity. Nobody hates sandwiches. It is like the most universally acceptable food. Who doesn't
bread.
Like sandwiches?
Right. It's not like he said, do you want a turkey sandwich? And she said, you know I don't like turkey. Like, right. We can find...
You know I fucking hate when things go between two pieces of bread. Get the fuck out of my face.
Maybe this is just Jonathan Blow's way of asserting that this is not the real world. Like,
right.
You know what I mean? Like, who in the real world would reject a sandwich? That's why this is
clearly all
clearly,
she's an AI construct.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know I hate sandwiches because I have no mouth. Begone with your foul presence.
You know I hate sandwiches and also I have no body but just a fully rendered shadow.
I hate sandwiches and I must scream. Yeah.
I was thinking the same thing.
Good.
Okay, the way I feel about this whole audio log thing, it's sort of like a step removed from you, Austin, where it wasn't so much the whole philosophical part of it that, I mean, I'm dumb, so I don't really even, I never would have even gotten that out of it unless I had heard you talk about it. So like, once I got to the very end of everything, I sort of started to put things together and find that sort of like cohesiveness between all the videos and audio logs and everything. Yeah. But before that, not only did it seem totally disjointed and bizarre, but my feeling of playing the game and feeling like as a game, it was so confident and well designed. It was sort of like it's super well designed and the game is like the game knows it and it's not going to hold your hand. It's just going to say, hey, here's the game. Just play it. Mm-hmm. We don't need to teach you anything because the game will do that.
Right.
And all this stuff. And then suddenly when I got those audio logs, I found the first one. It felt like the game went like 0 to 60 to like self-parodic levels of like introspective, austere indie puzzle game or whatever.
Right. Like if that game is about not needing tutorialization to teach you things, and then it's literally just like, oh, this is a tutorial for being a good person. Here's a famous quote. That's definitely a disconnect. Yeah. You're not wrong.
And they're so long. It's like the most masturbatory thing ever. Mm-hmm. Like, the whole game to me, gameplay-wise, feels like a mature, confident, like, masterpiece of design in a lot of ways. And then, like, the audio logs and the video things feel like Jonathan Blow's fucking high school notebook of like, oh, I liked this and I remember I read this passage and I can't cut this down to the most interesting part of it. I need the whole 6.5 minute thing because then you really get it.
And just to I don't know. Speak to that. I think this didn't actually end up in the game, so I guess it's neither here nor there as being a salient point, but there was this Atlantic profile on John Blow from a few years ago and like how the journalist in it was playing an early build of it. And he said all the audio logs were like very clearly like autobiographical like segments about John Blow's life. Hmm. And, like to the point like where he was describing like how his hairline grew and stuff like that.
Weird.
Which was clearly taken out. So like,
weird.
For all the people,
that's
like,
that game.
Yeah. For all the people that were saying, like, you know, I did have the thought at one point, like, you know, these audio logs are cool. I don't think it's an invalid way of kind of building a kind of belief system to kind of frame the gameplay, which I think it does succeed at that, whether you like it or you don't like what it's saying.
I don't know.
Totally.
But, you know, looking back to that and imagining just the audio logs where he's talking about, like, his childhood and growing up, like, would that even be preferable? Like, that almost seems worse to me in a way, because then that's, that is, like, to me, would be, like...
I want to play that game. I don't know that it would be better or worse. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm curious about what that would feel like. It might have been... It might be terrible.
And also, just about the audio logs, Austin, I know you're saying you're kind of hating the worldview that he kind of projects here, and I don't think that's invalid, but rather than that kind of, like, humanistic kind of point of view that he's presenting, it kind of almost just seemed like a form of, like, meditation, just with all, like, the Buddhist quotes and all of that thing. Like, the game is basically an exercise in mindfulness. Whether that is the thing to the end of, like, solving problems in the real world, I don't know. Maybe he is trying to do that.
The thing that kills me about that is, like, some shit that I... So there's a moment, for instance, at the end of that game in the mountain. One of the audio logs separates the two schools of Zen Buddhism, Rinzai and Soto. And there is a politics to that separation. There's like a historic separation between a sort of Zen Buddhism that could be made productive for people in power versus one that couldn't. And the game doesn't want to talk about that. Because like the person who's writing that quote doesn't want to talk about that. And in general, there has been that sort of separation of Eastern philosophy from its roots as like a lived practice of just people who live in the you know, geographical East and Southeast, to something that like tech dudes in California do,
right?
Or in the 80s and 90s, business dudes in California and New York did. And like, it doesn't, the version of meditation and mindfulness that it presents feels so much more like that to me than it does feel like the older form. And there's two, it's, I can't unpack this in a way that I feel confident enough to actually produce a piece of text and stand by and say, this is my interpretation of this thing.
Right.
It is totally a gut feeling based on what is presented here, or more importantly, what is not presented here. Like, there's no cruft, right? Like Eastern philosophy is actually filled with a bunch of stuff that does not seem really sensible to Westerners, and none of that is presented here. It's only the stuff that's like, yeah, I get it, and that's what kind of bugs me a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I wasn't aware of that divide at all, so that's... Yeah.
I remembered I had this word in my head of how to describe the sort of audio log, video log aspect of this, and I think I would use sophomoric.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
It just kind of smacks to me of like a thing that you tell yourself is way deeper than it really is, or maybe that there's more meaning, or like that... You don't have to consider outside perspective on any of it. It's just like
you've built you. It's like the story of like a little bit of knowledge can be a terrible thing in a weird way. I'm sounding way more harsh than I actually think I feel about this. Partially just because formally, I think the moment that you find the first audio log is really cool. Like, what is this? And the moment that you find the first video is just like pretty stunning.
It was surprising.
For me, it was like, what is this? So I actually found that a couple of months ago. Jeff Bacalar from CNET and I went to go talk to John Blow and play a build of the game back in like October, I think. And he just like left us in a hotel room with this game for 2 hours and was like, go ahead, just do a thing. And we got through symmetry and we got through the symmetry section. And then we wandered into we found the one door that you can get into that gives you the right... like hexagonal code to play that first video. We found that and saw it, and like that was the last thing we did. No, then we went to the mountain. But like, what a weird, like, what an amazing first impression when we had heard nothing about that stuff, right? Like, what is this game? Mm. Like, that there's a weird 12-minute video from some 1980s British documentary series. Like, what the fuck is going on?
I know, but like, ultimately, nothing, right?
Right,
like,
right. But at the time, that's why I think it's a better first impression than it is. necessarily. Yeah, it doesn't build into the like weird postmodern Andrew Ryan BioShock thing that I thought it might be moving towards, you know?
Yeah, and just, I know I mentioned this before, and it almost sounds silly if you haven't played the game, but I mean, those things are so long. That video clip you talk about, it's an interesting moment, and it's legitimately like an interesting piece of a show. Like, I enjoyed watching it, but that shit was like 15 minutes long.
Yeah.
And like, to sit there in front of a virtual theater screen in a game and spend 15 minutes watching something for not knowing what it is or why I'm watching it, it was just so weird.
Did you see what the reward is for the challenge?
I did, and I sat through all of that, and oh my god. Holy
John,
shit.
Do you know what it is?
I know what it is. I haven't listened to it yet.
Okay.
I'm trying to carve out an hour of my day to listen to it, if you guys think it's worth it.
Wait. Maybe I'm mixing up. Which one is the, like, the audio, like, the mainly audio one with, like, the moon...
Yes, that is the challenge.
Oh, okay.
Is that
Brian
Moriarty one, the Psalm 49?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I believe Psalm
49.
Yep.
The secret of Psalm 49.
Mm-hmm. That one I listened to 20 minutes of, and it was different because after I found it, I decided that I would listen to it on YouTube at work.
Yes.
Which was a way better listening experience because, what you know, for obvious reasons, it didn't feel like I was wasting my game time. Right. And I listened to about 20 minutes of it, and I really enjoyed it, and I want to finish it.
Yeah, he's great. Brian Moriarty is, like, legit one of the... I just saw him give a talk recently. He's, like, fascinating, and I love his speaking voice, and he has interesting things to say. So I'm glad it's in that game, for sure.
Yeah.
But also, I even think, to John's point about mindfulness before, there's maybe even something to be said about, like, no, motherfucker. Like, you're going to sit down and watch this thing. You're going to listen to this guy talk for an hour. But also, I don't have an hour.
Right. Yeah, like, it... I'm in my whatever, like, fucking 40 hours it took me basically to play the entire game minus the time challenge and a couple of the most difficult puzzles in the game. Mm-hmm. And I never, throughout that whole process, I never felt like the game was disrespecting my time. But those audio logs and videos felt like they had almost like an outright hostility towards my time.
Right.
Like, mm-hmm. They were wasting my time. They were like, Jonathan Blow was relishing in wasting my time, which was really weird.
Just to invoke another Jonathan Blow quote from his Reddit. He did a Reddit AMA the other day.
Ooh.
And someone was like, why did it take you so long to make the game? Do you feel like you, like, wasted so much time? And he was like, no, 7 years isn't a long time. Watch the movie Jiro Dreams of Sushi, and, like, you'll find that, like, to that guy, 7 years is nothing or something like that. So I think John Blow has a different sense of time or different sense of the value of time than most other people. So
yeah, like,
sure.
Yeah, I think, and he
well,
wants
I mean,
to
Braid taught
us that.
That, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Hey!
What taught us that?
Braid.
Oh, right. The time potion game.
Yeah. He never...
Hey-o.
Well, that's the thing, is that John Blow never runs out of the time rewinding potion, so he doesn't have to think about how much time something takes.
John Blow is really the Andrew Ryan character of The Witness.
Oh,
right,
God.
That's true, right? Like, and is even gestured at in, I guess, sort of in the cave stuff, because, like, oh, they're building a weird, I guess, VR. I'm not even sure. I haven't even stitched together what the actual plot stuff there is yet, which is part of why I haven't finished writing this thing. But then in the VR ending also.
Yeah, right. It seems like it's a VR thing. Those audio logs in the cave made it sound like you're listening to the people that are making the game that is within the game and all this stuff. It's almost a shame that it's been so long since the game came out that, like, all their... Like, the easiest stuff to talk about is all this weird quote-unquote story stuff.
Mm-hmm.
When right after I finished the game, what I really wanted to do was a spoiler cast about, like, the game itself and the mechanics.
Well, let's talk
but
about that.
It's harder to have that conversation now, I feel.
Well,
like,
what was your favorite area? How about that? How about we just start with, like, a real basic thing of just, like, of the 11 basic areas, which one did which one did you find yourself, like, the most amused and challenged or just you enjoyed the most?
Probably the Shadow Forest.
That was
a good
one.
That place was cool.
I feel
I don't
like
know.
a lot of them, they seem kind of equal in my mind. Symmetry Island kind of stood out to me. I felt like the game... So, you know, like, when a game... When you start playing a game and you see, like, five different awesome things all up front, and you're like, holy shit, there's so much variety in this game. There's a million things in this game. And then you keep playing and you realize, like, oh, wait, this is just 30 hours of the same five things over and over again. Yeah. And I felt like The Witness was the opposite, where I started it and I was really hesitant about a game where you're walking around in an environment, but instead of, like, creative puzzles that are big and crazy, like in Myst, it's like it's all just line puzzles. I was like, how do you make, like, an engrossing puzzle game out of that? And as I was playing it in the beginning and I went to Symmetry Island first, I was like, man, I don't know. Like, this is kind of interesting, but eh. And then I feel like everything else was way more interesting than that. Like, it so doesn't show its hand right up front. Right.
Well, I think that's, like, most people finish that first, so it's almost kind of like a de facto first level in some ways. Yeah. But I just thought I'd revise my statement on the favorite area. I think the Keep is my favorite for a very particular reason.
Oh, interesting.
Because I think most of the areas in the game, they're either environmental or they're based on the various symbols. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that one was kind of... or maybe not just the symbols that they focus on, but just focus on, you know, the maze that you're looking at. And I feel like the Keep's puzzles kind of combine those two in a way that was very satisfying and very
so
clever.
The Keep, are you talking about the
hedge mazes and the pressure plates? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Wait, did you do both sets?
Yeah, you have to do both, don't
okay.
you?
Okay. You do not have to do both sets.
Oh, really?
Just one.
I only did the hedge mazes because I did not have the time to do both. And I hit the, I did like the first two pressure plates, I think, and then I got to the third one. No, I have other stuff to do with my life right now.
No, I actually really love those pressure plates just because of the way they play with the environment and the fact that you're also just looking at a puzzle panel too. And I felt they kind of coalesced in a way that was more satisfying than the other areas.
That I just recently, so like now that I finished like basically every puzzle in the game, the only thing left for me was the plus one, quote unquote plus one puzzles, the environmental things. And obviously those pressure plate ones are those. But the thing is that when you stand up at the top of the Keep and look down to try to do that, you realize that the perspective of it, you probably have to redo all your solutions so that you can get that plus one puzzle out of it. So that was like a whole new thing. It was like, I thought I had solved those puzzles, but actually I had to go back and make completely new solutions for all of them to really solve them. So that was kind of like an interesting,
that's
like
really cool.
Yeah. I discovered puzzles I didn't realize were still there.
Nothing ever comes from those environmental puzzles, right?
No, like they just fill up the black obelisks.
Man.
Yeah. Apparently like the obelisks turn white and then the fountains in the lake, start spitting water a little bit higher each time.
I mean, I can't say with definitive knowingness that they don't do anything more, because there are many people on Reddit trying to kind of uncover the secrets of this game still. I would be very surprised if there aren't.
This is the same thing with me in the cave stuff of just like, yeah, it's so deep. If only this one tiny super percent of your player base is ever going to see it, it's so hard for me to care. And I think that's probably unfair, but it's also is just how I feel, that like most people are not going to see this part of your game because it's so, if there is anything at all, right? Like if there is anything besides the fountain goes higher, you know?
I don't know. Yeah. It's such a mysterious game. And I feel like in a lot of ways, it's a game that you don't want it to end. Like you want to tell yourself that there's always one more puzzle to solve.
Yeah. If I like went into work tomorrow and there was a message on Slack that was like, Austin, there's still another thing in The Witness you have to go do.
Yeah.
I would totally be hyped to come home and do that.
Yeah,
night,
of course.
You know?
But I just don't think there is anything else. And in some ways, I feel like that's a lost opportunity. Like, I feel like, I don't know. It's insane because it's a 50-hour puzzle game, and I wish that there was a lot more of it. Yeah. And in a way, I'm almost sad because the game is so much, you know, built around knowledge that you have and knowledge that you don't have, that it's kind of impossible to play it again because I already know everything. Like maybe
5 years from now,
yeah,
maybe like, you go back.
Right, but then it'll always still be a case of like you see something, you go, I think I remember how this goes. Oh yeah, this is how this goes. Mm-hmm. Sort
so
of thing.
Maybe there's something there in that, like, there aren't, obviously you won't get that same joy again that you got once, but there are moments that are clever even though they're not challenging. Like there's a moment in, there's that moment in Symmetry when you realize that the line is disappearing.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Like, you're just like, man, fuck you. That's really good. and like, there's a couple of moments of that in the game that are just so good.
That was that is kind of like the first gotcha moment in the game. I remember doing those and being like, am I crazy or is that line fading?
Yep.
Like, is that not solid anymore? And then I was like, oh shit, son of a bitch.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The line was green, right? I'm just kidding.
What was interesting though, so when I finished the timed challenge thing and then after that finished the last puzzle I had, which was the one on the shipwreck, did either of you guys do that?
I haven't gotten to that one yet, still plugging away at the challenge.
That one is fucked.
What is it?
Oh, do you just want me to tell you like how to solve it, or
no? Just give me like a broad, like, what's the puzzle look like?
So when you just look at it, I found it way before I knew any of this. But when you just go there, it's like this big echoey ship with a bunch of crazy sounds happening, and you look at it, and it's a bunch of three colors of hexagons at different sizes. I think there's pink ones, black ones, and orange ones. And it's like a big grid. And then at the time when I first tried it, I would be trying to move my line around the puzzle and it would just weirdly stop randomly. And I didn't understand why that was happening. And I like, sometimes I couldn't go through a place, but then other times I could go through that place if I went a different route. And I didn't understand what was happening until I suddenly had like an aha moment and realized, oh, it's a mirror puzzle where the other line's invisible. They just don't explain it to you.
Right.
There's like so many layers to it. So it's a mirror puzzle where one of the lines is invisible. It's a color, like, the color isn't really part of the puzzle, but the thing is that there's a giant red light right next to the puzzle panel that you might not even realize that if you take away the red light, the colors would be blue and yellow instead of orange and pink. And that's how you would know it's a mirror puzzle. And then on top of that, you have to do that fucking sound thing where you like, listen
high, high, low, high, like that one.
Exactly. But here's the thing. So the sounds are water droplets, basically. Oh, like you hear just like plunk, plunk, plunk. But then every once in a while, the ship goes like, and I beat my head against this thing for hours because I was convinced that that those weird long sounds were just there to try to make it hard for me to hear the water drops, and but that it was all around that somehow. But in fact, the idea is that you have to, one line has to do the water drops, and the other line has to do the different pitches of crazy, weird groaning sounds.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, like that puzzle is super fucked. That's the one puzzle I did go online to get a hint about. And when I found a forum thread, and it was literally like a forum thread of some people that hadn't solved it and wanted to know how, and then people that had solved it trying to work together to figure out why they had solved it. Like, they didn't even know.
That's pretty good. I kind of like that.
I didn't like it.
Oh no, I like that conversation. Yeah. Not that puzzle. I just won't do that puzzle.
Yeah.
I changed my mind. This was you basically being on Slack saying, "Hey Austin, there's a new puzzle for you to solve." And my actual answer is no, fuck you.
Well, here's the thing. Now that I told you about it, you won't spend 4 hours on it like I did.
Right. Right.
It was interesting. The guy that essentially gave me the clue to beat it, he was like, I think one line is for the drops and one line's for the weird groan sounds. Like, I think that was a person, he was still speculating. He didn't know for sure.
Right.
But I'm pretty sure he had solved it, which was
like,
weird.
That's the stuff where, like, this game feels like, again, to go back to, like, okay, it's science plus mindfulness, right?
Yeah.
It illustrates all that. And to go back to what John was saying before about, how, like, how confident, or maybe it was you, Kyle.
It was me.
It was you saying, like, it was so confident at that stuff And I think it's the game side of it is like so, I hate saying it that way, but like the puzzle side of it is so filled with those metaphors where it's like, oh, like sometimes you figure a thing out, but you're not really sure what the solution is. And you have to like talk to other people, or like there's that one laser that's like, oh, I solved this laser, but it turns out that was going in the wrong direction. And the history of science is filled with people who think they've made discoveries, but really they've been off a little bit. Like,
oh,
that stuff
God,
is,
no.
Yeah. Yeah. No. It's all there, dude. Like, it's all there. Like, but like,
by the way, did you guys figure out how to turn the dark cloud white?
No.
I just figured that out the last time I played it. And so like that was the thing. It's like every time I feel like I've seen everything there is to see, there's like one little thing left. So I will give it that. It was like all of a sudden I was like, holy shit, I think this might work. And I went and tried it and the cloud turned white and I was like, oh my God, I'm a fucking genius.
But then that's it. You got the white cloud.
The white cloud, it lets you get another plus one puzzle.
Oh, it's another environmental.
Yeah.
What was the first environmental puzzle that you guys found? Or not environment, like the plus one.
It was desert. The lines on the steps of the desert temple.
It was weird because I saw a few of them really early in the game. But I guess I was like too close or didn't have the perspective quite right. So when I tried to get them, it didn't work. So I was like, oh shit, I guess that's just not a thing in this game. So then I went like 25 hours without even trying any of that. And then I finally got one that's like on the front of the monastery. Like that one that goes around the steps and everything.
Yeah.
Here's the thing about the environmental puzzles that kind of weirds me out and makes me think that J-Blo, as it were, was kind of like, maybe giving away his hand a little bit too much, given the point of the game. But when you get to the top of the mountain and there's that one puzzle that's in the shape of the river below, and it seems like the only reason that it's there is to call attention to the fact that there is an environmental puzzle right below it in case you hadn't noticed them prior to the time that you had gotten there.
Yeah.
Which I'm like struggling to understand why he put that there, because it seems like the whole point is like you're going through this entire process and then suddenly, you know, through this ingenious system that he has created, you'll realize you can break free of it and then go through the environmental puzzles. But he's like, nope, here's a little hint, you can just do it. And I just felt like, I was like, why is this, like, what is he trying to get at here if he's like kind of giving it away?
I see your point. It's not, like I said, I tried a bunch before I even knew that it was a thing you could do, so it's not like it's the hardest thing to stumble upon. Like,
they're
fucking everywhere.
Just like science or ideology. Like, once you see it, it's everywhere.
It's true, though. Like, I saw a few of them, but of course, once you find one, suddenly you're just seeing them everywhere. And you're like, oh my God, how did I miss these?
Totally. Again, I think that's actually fairly clever in a way of just like, anytime you've started to study something that is so core to human existence or core to society or whatever, like, oh wow, I see this in everything I see now. The first one for me was actually after I watched the Connections video again. So I'd seen that Connections video a couple of months ago.
Connections video?
That's the first video that you see. The James Burke one.
James Burke. No, this person doesn't have a name. Why would you tell me that? He's just a weird, crazy guy
from England.
Some random fucking video from somewhere I don't know where.
So I came out of the windmill, and at that point, you know, I'd basically only played stuff I'd already played, right? So I'd done Symmetry, which I'd already done a couple of months ago, and then I did that puzzle to get the James Burke stuff, and I watched that again, and then I left the windmill, and I'm like, okay, now where do I want to go? Oh, you know, let me see if there's anything else going up in that windmill, and I turned around and saw the symbol on the windmill, and when I activated it there, that like was another this immediate just like, holy shit, like there's, is this going to be a whole new thing? Like, is this going to be, and then no, again, no.
There's
and
not
like,
really anything to it.
It's so, I don't know if I wanted it to be more like Myst in that way, where there's this ridiculous story about the person, maybe there's a story about the person on the island who is making these puzzles. Like, you find that workshop pretty early on with like the melted puzzle stuff. I don't know. I don't know if I wanted characters in this game or not, but I kind of did, even though some weird part of me did
that's
want.
A workshop where they're making puzzle panels?
Yeah, I think so, like, because it's all melty. Do you know the one I'm talking about?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I think that's what that is. Or, like, again, like, we could talk about, we could, it feels like there's almost a story about this island there of, like, oh, there is this natural property of this place, and there were these old ruins where it was used on this one material, and then this guy found that out and then tried to build it. Like,
yeah, it does seem like it's trying to tell a story through its environment. And I think at certain points, especially anytime I would find one of those, like, statue people, I'd be like, am I dumb? Because I don't really feel like I'm getting much out of this at all.
Why is there a king here? What is happening?
What was that dude jamming to on his guitar, a little mini amp? That's what I want to know.
Who knows? One of my favorite things, though, is definitely the... there's a couple statues where if you look at them in weird different places, they change dramatically. There's the lady in the marsh who's in the cage. Do you know the one I'm talking about?
No.
There's a lady. Do you know the marshes with the Tetromino pieces?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Oh, the Tetrominos.
I can't say that word. Tetronimos. There we go. There's a lady who's like reaching up out of a broken cage statue. And if you line it up right, she's reaching up to the angel lady on the mountain who's reaching down to pull her out. And that was a very like, oh, that's interesting. Okay. That's clever.
And then
that's
there's one after the apple forest, which doesn't have the laser. Mm-hmm. There's the one where you get to the end of that and there's the dude crouching up at the wine goblet. And he's not holding it because he's reaching for it. But like the shadow of it looks like he is holding it.
Right.
Yes. Yes.
Did any of you guys find anything to do on that one little island? Because it seemed like there wasn't anything.
Which one?
The one with the wine and the guy reaching for it.
There's just the diagrams of like the hearts growing into or out of the trees, right?
No, that's in a different place.
You're thinking of you're talking about the trees with the apples that fell. And then, there's also that side island.
Yeah,
that's the thing that Kyle's talking about.
The guy reaching for the wine glass is in a totally separate place from those.
I was mixing
them
up, I guess.
Yeah, I don't think I did. I don't think I found anything there.
The pink trees was a little disappointing because I liked that puzzle a lot, but didn't really get you anything material. Maybe I'm just too superficial of a video game player at some point, but I just feel like I wish there was a little bit more gaminess to some of it, like. Like, all those plus one puzzles, there's, like, fucking, like, 200 of those things in the game or something. And like we said, they don't really get you anything. Like, I feel like that game would have really benefited for some sort of, like, material reason to go around collecting those. Like, I guess, I can't really even think of what that would be, but it felt like if you gave enough of a reason to push players to do it, that you could spend 20 more hours just doing that.
Right. Well, the other thing is they're not like the puzzles in that the rest of the puzzles are all sequential and like you get better at doing them and you learn a thing and that feels good. That feels innately good. Whereas it's just like, oh, I found another puzzle. Do you get a little splash of something? A little bit of like, ooh, I found one. But then it's not like I'm learning about finding those puzzles. Really, right. You know?
Or, there is sometimes still a sort of a puzzle around like, you find one, you're like, this is obviously a plus one puzzle, but I can't figure out how to get it.
Right.
And then you
what speed
it.
Do I need to set the boat at to get this one? Fuck, man.
Those boat ones were cool, but they were a pain in the ass to have to keep
they're so
going
long.
Back and forth. I know.
Yeah, and because your stupid line boat can't just go in reverse really quickly. Getting that boat was a cool moment also. I was just like, I got gear in this game that like makes navigating around this thing really cool and fast.
Honestly, that boat is in like the launch trailer on Steam or whatever for the game, and like that was basically what sold it for me because I love Myst, and like that's such a Myst thing of like a fucking boat rises out of the water and then you're on a boat now, and I'm like, fuck, it sold all my money. I don't care if this game's $40.
Yeah, I think I'm glad that The Witness exists. I had a good time with it. I have some reservations, but I fundamentally had a real unique time with it. And I don't know if John Blow's goals, if he met those necessarily. Like, he's kind of famously said he set out to fix Myst. He told me that he was trying to make the first truly authentic game. And like, you don't need to make those, like, you just make your cool puzzle game, dog. Like, that's good enough.
Sorry, hang on one second, Austin.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Hey, I'm back.
And because back. The reason I brought that up is because, Kyle named his daughter after one of the bosses of Bloodborne. So.
Yeah, of course.
That's true.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's true.
Yeah, you just missed me talking about how David Enten, who's next to me, is playing Bloodborne right now.
Oh, shit. David Enten's over there?
Yeah, he just moved here. He's crashing with me.
I haven't seen that kid in a hot minute.
He says he misses you.
One of my signature catchphrases. Hot minute. Oh, wait, shit. That's a reference to a thing no one heard.
Yeah, that's okay. Well, that's, don't worry about it. That's for us.
Yeah, sorry. I had to duck out of the conversation for a second, but it I wish I hadn't had to, because it came right at Jonathan Blow saying he was going to fix Myst.
He said he wanted to fix Myst and make the first truly authentic game. And, like, what? You don't need to do that. Like, you don't need to make those claims.
Yeah.
You made a good game. You made a game that's really good, and it doesn't need to be the only X. It doesn't need to be the solution to another. The game, the world of games is not itself a puzzle that needs to be solved.
Did he actually proclaim this to be the first authentic game ever?
Yeah, dog, in, like, interview with me, and I was like, excuse me? Like, we tried
Holy
to, like,
shit.
I tried really hard to walk him through why I had problems with that without ending the interview. Do you know
what
I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah, that's amazing.
That's on giantbomb.com if you want to go dig that up.
Giantbomb.com.
Giantbomb presents fees. A feed. But yeah, like he really wanted to say that most games intend to say that they're one thing. Like, here's the best version of his argument. Okay. What he was saying was, like, I'm gonna be as generous as I can be to him. He said, like, okay, this game is ostensibly a game about being a space marine and about patriotism, but really it's a game about, like, hiding behind cover and shooting things.
Yes.
And that's not what being a space marine is.
I think I actually remember this.
And there's, like, that first step of analysis is really solid. You know,
yeah,
I think that
that's
the first step of a lot of good game critique. But
yeah,
then
absolutely.
To go, like, and then what I'm going to do is make a game that is only truly about the thing it says it wants to be about.
Like, that's impossible.
It's impossible. And it's better for me to say that's impossible. So I'm just going to do my best to be aware of what the weird hidden biases are and, like, what my failings can be and all that shit. Than it would be to say what I'm going to do is make the first truly authentic whatever. And that's just, like... Ah,
that,
God.
In a weird way, that feels, God, I know I'm not going to be able to put this the way I want to say it, but it feels like you're being a bad scientist or whatever. Like, science is all about, you know.
Yeah.
You know, knowing where it can go wrong, you know, if you're setting out to make a game that is only about its thing and you think that's a real thing, that's like the weirdest form of confirmation bias I've ever heard of.
Totally. And also because there's a quote in the game, I think it's maybe the Richard Feynman one, talking about, like, scientific certainties and uncertainties.
Yes.
And I just, that quote in regards to what he's just saying is kind of ironic in a way he probably doesn't mean it to be.
Which one is that one?
The Richard Feynman one. I forget where it is.
Yeah, me too. There's like three Feynman quotes in there. He's one of the people they go back to a bunch.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Why aren't they all right together?
Oh, man. No, because one of them is in the... one of them's in the marsh, because I think that's the wine one.
Mm-hmm.
And then I want to say another one's in the treehouse, but maybe that's wrong.
They definitely seem to have a weird fixation with a lot of these in the idea of the relationship between science and God.
Totally. Mm-hmm. Totally. Did you find that one in the caves?
Yeah, the one where it's the people, like, kind of having a round table about it, and they're talking about material atheists and not having...
they didn't want to exclude other belief systems.
No, none of them having put forth a really truly compelling argument for atheism, and that they're all... any argument that they could find is all just trying to disprove really provincial... Yeah.
Yes.
Concepts of gods, like Christian God and that kind of thing.
Not just like general, not like a general statement of what you do believe as a material atheist.
Right.
Atheist.
They're all just negative
proofs.
So
that actually,
I feel like that's like a misunderstanding of, like, what material atheism is about at its core, which is essentially saying, you know, like, any good scientist is honest about what they don't know. And so... You can only say to people who say, I'm sure of this thing, and you go, like, no. Like, you can only say what is clearly not true. You can't make assumptions. Like, it doesn't make sense if you're a scientist or you have a scientific mind to say, like, I'm sure that there's no God, because you know that you're not sure. That's the whole point of it.
That's the whole point.
Maybe that's why it's in the blooper cave, man.
The blooper cave.
The blooper cave. Yeah. I love it. God, could you imagine if there were just straight up blooper audio logs in there, or like, or blooper puzzles? That's what it is, Kyle. The puzzles that you couldn't solve. Those are just bloopers. God. Those are just bloopers.
Holy shit! Wait, there was one last secret to the witness, and we just solved it.
It's the blooper cave.
Oh man, that's awesome.
Oh, we're the best. We're really good.
Yeah.
It's so hard not to just make this the, like, I didn't like this quote podcast, but I am going to do one more quote I really didn't like, because it's going to spin off to something I actually did like about the game, which is there's a quote in the quarries, which is a section that I actually, oh God. So I had to go back to the quarry. I was in the mountain. I was in like one of the final stages of the mountain,
mm-hmm.
and I got to, cause I was trying to finish it so I could decide if I wanted to write about it or not. And I got down through the mountain until maybe it was the final floor puzzle. Maybe it was, I think it must have been, because there the
that's the one with all the, like, I don't even know what to call them, but the symbol that's in the quarry.
That's in the quarry. That cancels out. Like windmill out. It's like the three line thing. The cancel out one, yeah.
Yeah.
Which I like a lot. But I got all the way down there, I was like, oh fuck, I have no idea what this symbol is.
Yeah.
Let me go find this.
So I had a weird thing when I got to the quarry where the quarry made me realize, like, I kind of picked up on what the mechanic was of, like, that symbol canceling something out
mm-hmm.
after a while, though I did solve a number of them before I really understood what was happening.
Me too.
But that area also made me realize that I didn't fully understand the square puzzles up to that point. Because
the different color squares?
Yeah, so it was...
Yeah.
So those... They seemed to be behaving differently than the black and white puzzles to me, and I thought it was because they were a different color, and then I came to realize that I just didn't fully understand the black and white ones when I learned them. Like,
right.
You know, it's all about sectioning them off, but I thought it was specifically about drawing lines between any instance of a black and white one touching, which
right.
is totally different.
Correct. Yeah, that was I've had that conversation with someone else who also thought that's a pretty common one of those things. Is like, oh, it's easy to believe that based on preliminary,
right,
like the preliminary puzzles, but deeper puzzles require you to know that second step.
Exactly.
And so yeah, the quarry puzzles were really great for teaching me, like, it actually kind of made me feel way smarter about the rest of the puzzles. Like, I felt like I developed a more critical understanding of basically every other puzzle because I had to start thinking about them in this more holistic sense of, like, okay, let me compartmentalize this one over here so I can cancel out the failure. That was really great. But while I was there, I found a quote. And there was a quote there that was like, I'm going to butcher this because it's been a while, and I have it written down somewhere, but not in front of me. It's basically like, people who try to get into heaven alone will succeed, and there they will be welcomed into the collective. But anyone who tries to get into heaven together with someone else will find themselves like failing alone.
What?
Again, the Andrew Ryan comparison
yes,
coming
again.
Back here.
And it's just like, the thing that kills me about that, I'm gonna look it up because I literally have it right here. The thing that kills me about it is my favorite bit about this game is playing it with other people in the room and working out puzzles with them.
I never had that experience, unfortunately.
Yeah, I only had that a little bit, but that was enjoyable.
It was like the most... Being able to, like, say...
Are they saying that, you know, if you solved it with other people, you didn't truly solve it?
I didn't truly solve it at all. I'm such a cheater.
Yeah.
It is...
And God knows, and he's going to punish you for it.
That's it. I'm done. It's a Hugh Kingsmill quote, I think. And it's basically something like, the kingdom of heaven cannot be obtained together... only through solitary work. And like, no, like,
yeah.
That's okay. Like, you're right. There's joy to be had in sitting down. When I played the challenge alone by myself, I did feel something really special. And that puzzle specifically could not really be done, I think, with a partner. It would just get in the way. But like, sitting down for the first time when I played this game with Jeff Bacalar from CNET and being like, What the fuck are we doing? Like, how? And then the other one goes like, oh, look, like, here's the thing you didn't see. Like, that's a really fun and rewarding method of moving forward. And
totally. Co-op Portal was exactly
that. Totally. And I just feel like maybe that's what it comes down to, is I wish the curation of those quotes had been a little bit tighter or a little more thoughtful or something, because there's so many that are... that run against the best aspects of this game.
Conversely, the quote I did really like, not in context, but there's the Tarkovsky film clip.
Yes.
And I love Tarkovsky. He's one of my favorite filmmakers.
Great
filmmaker.
But
I feel like...
I have to interrupt you mid-sentence. I'm so sorry about this. Clip is a very generous word
the Tarkovsky
for
reel
what you are
film,
describing.
Okay.
That was a full film. Go ahead.
Anyways, so there's a scene from a Tarkovsky movie where a character is kind of trying to light a candle and keeps getting put out from the wind, for those who are listening and haven't seen it.
Right.
But I feel like Tarkovsky would probably be rolling in his grave if he found out, like, the context it was being used in, because Tarkovsky is a very, like, that movie is all about the pursuit of, like, artistic self-expression and, like...
Right.
Like, Tarkovsky was, like, a very spiritual dude, and I feel like he would be very against this game and how that excerpt was presented, but...
Right, it's, like, kind of removed from its context and presented to be about, like... Not just not artistic thought, but like this, like I'm working towards success and progress.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And like, ooh, no, you're missing it a little bit.
I'll be honest, I don't really know a lot about that. But when I first saw that clip, I was so baffled and upset about like how long it was and how little there was to it. And then after slamming my head against the final timed challenge for so many hours, and then thinking back and like drawing a comparison between that candle scene and what I was doing in that cave, and I was kind of like, ah, shit, I almost hate to admit it, but I kind of see what you're getting at here.
Yeah. God. Well, I do think at the end of the day, I think I'm still pretty positive on the game.
Yeah.
I loved the game. It was weird. Like I said, 40 to 45 hours, I loved that game, and then a bunch of shit all at the end made me feel really sour about it, but
yeah.
I had so much fun with it.
I think the mountain was, like, kind of disappointing. I think that the, like, stepping into the elevator is kind of disappointing.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And just, man,
I didn't think the mountain was that difficult, except for the Tetris, like, humongous floor puzzle. It was just, most of the puzzles were pretty simple, but the ones that were moving were just like, man... Stop, please.
So I had
simple puzzles, but like I'm getting sick here. Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was interesting, though. It was fun.
I had trouble with the bridge building one, where you have to run back and forth a bunch of times.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That's mostly because I was being really lazy and like I just did not want to bring out the graph paper until it was very clear, like, okay, I have to sketch this out.
Oh,
I guess.
Probably should have done that, huh?
Yeah, it's useful, let me tell you.
Oh well. I did that for one photos. I did that for one puzzle in the game. I used paper. Oh, actually...
Go ahead. Someone noted, I think it was on Idle Thumbs, maybe, that Snapchat is, like, the best witness app.
I've been using Snapchat straight up, in the challenge to take pictures of the map.
Yeah, you can just straight up draw on your pictures in Snapchat. I know.
Oh, man.
So upset hearing it. It's okay. So good.
Yeah, I used paper for that one maze in the town... where you have to, like, go through the maze and then draw your route. And I was like, I'm never going to remember this.
Oh, yeah, that one, too. That was really tough.
And the other thing was that all the... I just, like, in my head think of them as Tetris puzzles, even though there are all kinds of shapes, not just the ones in Tetris. But there is one in the swamp that you don't have to do that is totally skippable that I found later. And I realized that it had exactly one each of all the shapes in Tetris. And Lucas has in his bedroom, we got for him, like, a weird lamp that has the... It's, like, a super cool lamp, but it's a nightlight where all the Tetris blocks, like, you stack them together and they have metal contacts on the outside, so they light up when stack them together. And I was like, oh, shit, I have a visual aid for this. And I ran and got the blocks and, like, figured it out in physical space.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah.
Nice. I like, have, like, the biggest love-hate relationship with that, with those puzzles. I think that maybe that I ever had in a video game of just like, I was never closer to quitting this game as in the swamp.
Yeah.
Because my brain just doesn't, I'm terrible at that sort of spatial reasoning. But also when I finally got through it and you get the boat and like, it's like, fuck you, I did it. I'm the best. Like that totally paid off.
I think I got the boat somewhere else.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I got it somewhere else too. I think I got it. Outside of the... No, I don't even remember.
But yeah, that's
totally possible.
The swamp was definitely where I felt the most like frustrated despair outside of like any of like the really late game stuff. And that was, I think, where I first initially broke, and like I was just like, John, you have to give me a hint on this shit. Like, it's driving me crazy. And I realized that was like when you first had to figure out the concept of how the blocks can be rearranged, like that the yellow shapes themselves did not have to be inside their larger shape, that you could rearrange them.
Yes.
Because even though that, and I've heard this sentiment echoed, I think, on the Bombcast or something, like even though the earlier puzzles teach you that concept, it doesn't really ingrain it, I feel like, well enough before they just sort of throw you out into these like more challenging puzzles. I don't know. Or maybe it's just a hard concept to wrap your head around.
Also with the Tetris pieces, I was going through one of my attempts at the challenge today, and there's that one of those four that has the Tetris puzzle in it, and it like is still giving me new shapes that I have not seen anywhere on the island. And I'm like, are you serious? God. You're just throwing new stuff to me right now?
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah. It was funny is like the Tetris puzzles were definitely my Achilles heel. And then in the challenge, by the end of it, this kind of talks to something that Kyle said before, which is like, I could do those really quickly for some reason, whereas I was starting to run into problems with the symmetry puzzles. Mm-hmm. Right, I don't know if symmetry or like this. Those
hung me up the most.
So it's just definitely nice to think about, like, I can tell you how I got better at this game in a way that's uniquely different than just like getting better at a fighting game or getting better at like a shooter or something. Like, it is a unique pleasure.
You were learning.
And learning is fun, you know?
And though maybe that's all John Blow wanted you to do.
He just maybe wanted to. Yeah. We all learned a little bit about the weird triangle puzzles and a lot about ourselves.
That shit was tough, too. Like, the actual, like, doing the weird triangle, that's the hardest part. Was the hardest part for me of the challenge, for sure.
Yeah, yeah, it definitely was. We talked about, I think I've talked to both of you separately about this, but that it was really cool that they taught you that with all those puzzle panels that were just like scattered around. Mm-hmm. And like, you know, maybe you solved one by accident at first, and then after a couple you were like, oh, I think it's this, and then it is that. And then by the end you feel like you're a master at those kinds of puzzles, but they never really challenge you with them until the timed one, and then suddenly it's like impossible.
And it's so deep in the process. And it's yet at the same time is not the last part of the process.
Oh, man. God, that was the thing. Is that time challenge was such a cool idea. And it feels like it flies in the face of the whole spirit of the game up to that point. But I kind of get where they're going, where they are coming from of like, maybe they wanted to put one challenge in the game that was really going to test really test you in like a execution sort of way. But ultimately, I just felt like it was luck of the draw. Like, it just felt like if I got easy puzzles, I got far. And if I didn't get easy puzzles, I failed.
True. Yeah. Listen, man, that's just like life. Sometimes you're just dealt a different hand, okay?
Yeah, but that sucks, though.
But sometimes it's awesome. Really? Sometimes that you just luck out.
That actually, I feel like, flies in the face of the philosophy of, of The Witness.
But if it was going to happen anywhere, it would be in the caves where everything is flying in the face of the philosophy of The Witness.
It is the blooper cave. So they were like, don't put that in the game. Put this in the cave.
Hide this puzzle in the cave.
And like, hearing Jonathan Blow's explanation, you know, there are people have raised concerns about the color blindness stuff with all the color-based puzzles. And having Jonathan Blow's explanation for it be like, well, you don't have to finish it. It kind of... Like, I was really disappointed when I finished that timed challenge and all I got was another clip, because it almost feels like I see where they're coming from. Like, Jonathan Blow wants to be like, well, I don't want there to be anything too great or important behind this super hard thing, because then, you know, so many people won't see it.
Right.
But then it just felt to me like I wasted 6 hours beating this thing and didn't really get anything for it. Hang on one sec. Wrapping up.
Spoilers.
Oh, man.
So how far is your friend into Bloodborne?
He's currently battling Father Gascoigne.
In the graveyard.
Oh, yeah, and I think he elected to go through to him instead of the cleric beast first, it seems like.
Oh, boy.
Oh, he's giving me
that's
looks.
A choice.
He's giving me looks like he didn't know he could do that.
Had an option?
Oh, I totally skipped the cleric beast. But hey, we should probably wrap this up because I have a very unhappy baby in my house and even more unhappy partner that has been alone with this baby for this entire time. So
okay.
Maybe final thoughts. Oh, I wanted to say real quick, in recording. So when I do these podcasts, I put on YouTube video backtracks to them of just like me playing games and stuff. And to get footage for that, and because I wanted to see if I could get footage of someone who hadn't played The Witness playing the beginning of The Witness. And I couldn't do it, obviously, so I had Nicole do it. And it was really interesting watching her play the beginning of that game to see how meticulously designed the opening sections of that game are, because when I played it by myself, I just felt like I was walking wherever and stumbling upon things. But then I was watching it played by someone else, I realized how perfectly everything in the world is laid out, so that like you go through that opening section, you follow the cables, and then you're almost guaranteed to find that one door with the puzzle that's way too hard for you to kind of like hint at, like, hey, there's more to this stuff, and then, you know, it, et cetera, et cetera. There's even this one, anybody watching this will have already seen this part of the video. There's this one great part where she gets to that fork where you can either go to the pink trees or the mirror island, whatever the fuck. And she just kind of like, she sees the pink trees and then sees the canyon and like, steps towards the canyon and then stops and then looks back at the trees and then looks back at the canyon and the trees and then goes like, all right, I'm going to go through the canyon. I'm just like sitting there with a big smile on my face. Like, this is so interesting.
Yeah. And that's one of those things where it's like, when John Blow says this is a truly authentic game and it presents itself as this open world that you can tackle from any direction you want. Like, no, it isn't. And that's okay. Like, it's okay that this is a design space, that this is sort of a Disney world or like, sort of like, you know the difference between French and British gardens in history?
No.
This is a weird thing. So French gardens were these like immaculately manicured, like hedge mazes and like huge, specific, symmetrical, geometric works of art. And British gardens are equally like toiled over, carefully plotted, but designed so that when you saw it, you said, oh, nature is beautiful, natural. Look at how beautiful it is naturally. But actually, it's still like completely trimmed and set up to pretend to be just regular nature. And that's that is a lot of good games, is that, right? Of like, this just feels like a real place, even though it's a person has spent dozens and dozens of hours placing bushes and like trying to encourage that when Nicole sees those two options, she went to the canyon instead of going to the trees.
I think whoever it was on like Infinity Ward or something years ago, they had that great quote of every game is on rails. It's just a matter of how well you hide the rails.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's totally. And that's fine. Like, that's not. I think we often fall into the trap of saying, like, get rid of no more theme park games. No more like get rid of the rails. And like, that's such like a, I get it. I've been that dude.
People go to Six Flags for a reason, dog.
Exactly. And that's okay. Let's be honest about that. And let's push people to make the best Six Flags that they can, if they're going to do that.
Well, that's Six Flags Great Adventures.
Oh, that's the one, obviously.
Jonathan Blow set out to make the first true game, and instead he accidentally created a wonderful British garden, is what I'm hearing.
Yeah, and that's okay.
That's great. That's the best game of 2016 so far, I think.
Maybe his next game will be his French garden. You never know.
God, he says his next game is going to be his magnum opus.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
I'm not kidding.
This might be the event horizon for John Blow.
He legit said, like, the best artist of all time spent decades working on their work. And, like, after I've done The Witness. Geez. I was like, okay, cool.
Oh, man, I totally have to go. We didn't even get to talk about the whole end part with the real life.
I know.
Anyways, I thought it was really weird that it was
clearly...
That's
all I'll say is I like how he plays with coins for a second in there. That's it.
Yeah. I felt like that was overly long, too. But I thought it was interesting how their office was filled... It was all filled with stuff that looked like puzzles in The Witness. And it was kind of this weird, like, chicken and egg thing of, like, I think the game was trying to say, like, oh, he was dreaming about this stuff because it's where he lives or whatever. But in my head, it was like, okay, chicken and egg. Did they decorate it with witness puzzles because they were going to film this thing? Or did they film this thing because they had decorated everything with witness puzzles? I think it's that one.
Probably that one.
But final question, you guys, real quick. The jug, is it pee? Go.
It's definitely pee.
Yeah. I mean,
the straw doesn't touch the liquid.
I want to believe in the spirit of the X-Files comeback. I want to believe that it
thank
is
you
pee.
That's
thank you for having us on that note.
Thank you very much for
want to believe.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Jonathan Davies, Austin Walker, for being on this. It was a great time. I hope people enjoyed listening to it.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and
it was a blast.
I hope to
have
you guys back.
I've been wanting to talk about The Witness for weeks and like haven't had the opportunity to, so thank you.
Yay! Woo-hoo. All right, thanks for listening, everybody. Catch you next time.
See ya.